Starting off with a beer from a brewery I've never heard of before. This is Heckin' Big Chonker Imperial Porter from Off the Rail Brewing in Vancouver. So in addition to the usual beery stuff, they've added cocoa nibs, a little bit of vanilla lactose, some roasted malts, and some other special things in here. Imperial chocolate birthday cake. Not sure what to think about this yet. A little sweeter than I'm used to. Interesting. May do it again, I'm not sure. So anyway, today I am going to tear down this fingertip pulse oximeter that I got in a mailbag a few weeks back. These little devices you may have seen at your doctor's office in the last few years, they've become fairly common. And this particular cheap one sort of works. However, I've noticed since I've been playing with it for the last few weeks that even like 10 seconds apart or on a different finger, you'll get drastically different readings. And I've never had an oxygen reading show up higher than 97%. Apparently 95% is what a lifelong smoker who's otherwise healthy would get, or below that. And usually when I go to the doctor, I'm much higher than that because, you know, I ain't never smoked. I'll drink a smoky drink, but you know. Anyway, so I don't really trust the accuracy of this little, what was it, $8 plus shipping unit that I got from China. So in the interest of getting some value out of it, I'm going to tear it down and see what's inside. First, I guess we should look a little bit at sort of what it does. So you stuff your finger in there, as I demonstrated, and you've probably seen that. There is a little sensor down there, a little square sensor that goes underneath your fingertip. And up in the top there is a red LED. It looks solid when I'm looking at it in real life. That flashing is just the camera thing. And it just flashes for a little while and then fades out if it doesn't see any fingers in the way. If you put your finger in there, it keeps going for a very long time and it doesn't seem to time out, or at least not fast enough to worry about it anyway. So I'm guessing what it's doing is shining that red light through your finger and measuring transmission, I suppose. Let's just see if Wikipedia knows anything about these things. Of course Wikipedia does. So there's a different one, that's a bit more professional one, which connects up to the larger vital signs measuring device that would do pulse and blood pressure and whatever other things in a hospital setting or in a medical setting. But these simple little fingertip ones seem to be getting used quite a bit. There are some fundamental limitations to this technique, apparently. It's not a complete measurement of respiratory efficiency, but it is, it's a quick monitoring tool, I guess. So things that can affect it: sensor application, highly calloused skin, moving, some other symptoms. Also, apparently, darker skin versus lighter skin can have some impact, and fingernail polish or things like that can also impact its reading. I don't think I've got any of those going on. Yeah, that is my observation as well, that this particular cheap one anyway has quite unreliable results. So that's why I don't feel too bad about tearing it down. Anyway, the method of operation, it appears to shine two different wavelengths of light, 660 nanometers and 940, which is infrared. 660 is a visible red. It appears to shine those two through your finger at approximately those two wavelengths there that it's indicating. And it measures the transmission of those two wavelengths. Interesting. There is a bit of a different description. Okay, so it basically just measures the two different wavelengths of light, how much passes through, compares the two of them against each other, does some math, and gives you an answer. Interesting. So, as I said, this thing, because of its cheapness and whatnot, doesn't owe me anything. And if it's not accurate, there's no point in using it to measure stuff. So, apart we shall take it. Pop those two little caps off there, which does, oh yeah, it does release it. Okay. There's a big honking spring in there, It seems to be anchored there and there. Oh, that's soft, crunchy plastic. Okay, that opens it up a little bit. So there is the sensor down there, which is just kind of gooped in. Looks like a photodiode, and I'm going to guess that's probably what it is. So that and the battery connections are all that's on the bottom. Just pry those battery connections out. There we go. The only thing that's left on the bottom here that's useful is this lanyard. Yay, free lanyard. Well, whatever, salvage lanyard. So back to this. That is a little rubbery cushion for your finger to lay in. There's one of the springs, the other spring over there. And there is the other cushion that your finger goes into. Right, and the LED that blinks. Ah, and it does have four pads on it, so it might be a dual infrared and just normal red. Anyway, since it can't get at anything further in there, we'll try from the top. Well, that was easy. That was almost too easy. Okay. A little tactile switch push button there and transistor of some sort. No other components on this side except for the display. And that display looks like, yeah. So that is just a lens with little light guides in it, and there is the array of LEDs. Cool, so they didn't have to make a custom LED type of display. They just made a custom little bezel here with a transparent print. That's pretty cool. So what happens if we pop this guy out? Because I don't see any screws holding it in. It's just clips. There we go. Okay, so on the LED side of the board, we have some white solder mask on there. Just to create a background, I guess. We have voltage and ground there labeled, and this calls itself LED, but that isn't an LED, that should be the detector, unless it's a LED being used as a photodiode. That doesn't make sense. Anyway, other than that, and the LED, the only things on the board are a couple capacitors and this wee chip here. I don't even recognize the manufacturer logo, let alone the part number. Let me see if I can go and search for that. No, of course I couldn't find anything. The only part on that entire board that I could find is that transistor, which is a common little NPN transistor. So interestingly, it does still sort of work. The light comes on, and although I can't get it to show me anything other than just lighting up the display on the back, but it never detects. I guess it needs a certain amount of darkness around it to see what's going on with the finger, or at least to exclude external light so that this thing doesn't false trigger or something. I'm interested in seeing if I can read that light at all. And this is not super easy to do. This thing doesn't give you a really good indication. It's not the best spectrograph, but it is showing some in the 550 and the 640, but it doesn't show up into infrared, so that doesn't really help me very much. I probably need a better tool for that job, but the better tool for the job costs way more than pretty much every piece of equipment in my shop, so that ain't gonna happen. So in diode test mode, this thing does appear to be a photodiode. When you darken it, it stops conducting. So that's pretty neat. And the light in here is just relatively wide spectrum white LED light. So it seems to react to most everything. And if I get it brighter, it conducts a lot more. Okay. And then of course when I shade it, it doesn't conduct. So that is, that's what you'd expect from a photodiode, but that's essentially what's going on with it. And then this little LED in here, what can we learn about him? So there is the red LED with a 1.7 volt forward voltage. It's there as well. And there we go. Looks like another diode, the 1.2 volt drop on it. Is that what an infrared LED looks like? Let's check just a random infrared LED here for forward voltage and just see, because they don't play with those very often. Yeah, 1.12. Okay. And can this camera see infrared? No, it doesn't look like it can. Okay. Even if I bring it right up to the sensor. No, it doesn't look like it. Okay. So there is actually an infrared LED in there. I just can't see it with my cameras. Well, that's pretty cool. Actually, hang on. So let's see if this infrared camera can read that IR LED. You see that the IR LED is turned on. Let's put that down on the bench. And where are we here? So there it is right in the middle. Does it change? I realize it's not the same wavelength of infrared. With that disconnected, it doesn't look like it changed any. Okay. So that doesn't tell me anything, which means I also won't be able to use that to read this guy here. Well, I guess there's not much else I can salvage out of there. I think that photodiode or phototransistor or whatever it is, I can probably make use of, or at least, you know, grab for future reference. Other than that, I think this thing is, has shown me as many of its secrets as possible, which is actually not very many, because 99% of everything is inside that little chip there. Oh well. At least now I know. Thanks for watching. Questions and comments down below. If you can find that chip number, please drop it in the comments. Although I'm pretty confident it's just going to be a microcontroller with a bunch of software on it, so there's nothing to learn there. Anyway, yeah, thanks for watching. I'll talk to you later.